So today we'll be looking at behaviorism and how it applies to learning. We are going to be focusing on the law of effect, classical conditioning, operant conditioning, and social learning theories. We will also be having a discussion on our course page after this video. So what is behaviorism? Behaviorism is a way of viewing the world of philosophy, psychology, and learning. It is one view of learning that can be taken alone or in conjunction with other theories. It focuses on measurable and observational behaviors, and it also propelled the legitimacy of psychology as a science through the use of the scientific method. Prior to behaviorism, psychology relied on information that was subjective to the individual, such as introspection, which was founded in structuralism and is a key factor in the start of behaviorism, as some psychologists wanted to promote an observational and testable approach to the science. So moving to the law of effect, the law of effect was created by Thorndike, and it states that what comes after a connection acts upon it to alter its strength. So Thorndike created the law of effect to act as a guide to research. He tested this by using puzzle boxes. Now, he found that as the trials increased, the time the cat spent in the box decreased, and he believed this was due to a positive consequence. So what happened was he would put cats in a box or a puzzle box, and they would be hungry. They wouldn't be starving, but they would be hungry. And he would then let them explore the box. And usually what happens in the first trial is the cat explores the box and will accidentally hit the lever that opens the door so the cat can leave the box and have some food. That was a positive experience. So he found that as the trials progressed, the length of the time the cat spent in the box was decreased because there was a positive reinforcement that was happening. So this really was looked at further with classical conditioning. So Pavlov stumbled upon the effects of classical conditioning while studying digestion, and he was looking at the production of saliva, as this is the first step in digestion. He found that dogs would start to salivate before they received food, notably when the lab assistants were making noise preparing the food. Pavlov decided to test this by introducing his own experiment of a bell to produce saliva. So we can actually use this type of experiment or example in that we can learn through associations, and these associations can be taught. So we're actually going to be pairing a neutral stimulus with a previous stimulus response pattern to create a new association, where a neutral stimulus does not elicit a response. So previous to the bell, or the dogs hearing the bell in the experiment, a bell would not produce a response in a dog. So this principle works by pairing, again, that neutral stimulus with an already occurring stimulus response pattern like a reflex. So a dog will involuntarily salivate when food is placed near their mouth, just as we will. So what he decided to do was he would pair a bell with a food, and over time the dog would learn the association that when it heard the bell, food was coming, so each time it would salivate. After conditioning, however, you could ring a bell and the dog would salivate because it learned that paired association between the bell and the food. So moving to operant conditioning, Skinner studied the effects of consequence on behavior using operant conditioning. Behavior will be modified based on the consequence that occurs, and behaviors can be strengthened or weakened based on these consequences. Skinner could either strengthen a response by using reinforcement or weaken a response using punishment. It is important to note that these terms are specific to operant conditioning and do not have to do with traditional methods of punishment. So to keep it simple, I'm just going to show you this chart here. Sorry, we will go back to that previous slide. When we're looking at increasing a behavior, we are going to be looking at the reinforcement section here, so these green squares. When we're trying to decrease a behavior, we're using punishment. If we're presenting a stimulus, we are using positive aspects, and when we are removing a stimulus, we are using negative aspects. So you can have positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, positive punishment, and negative punishment. So Skinner studied these changes of behaviors by using a Skinner box, and he could actually train animals to do things that didn't come naturally to them. For example, he would train rats to press a lever, and they would be rewarded with food. So through this method, he was very successful at training animals through these Skinner boxes by using reinforcement and punishment. So the social learning theory was created or pioneered essentially with Bandura. There are other psychologists as well, but we're just going to talk about Bandura today. So behavior is learned through observing and modeling. Interactions must be observable and cognitions, and they're conditional upon attention. So the individual must be paying attention to features being modeled. They must be able to hold on to this information using retention. They must be able to reproduce this behavior. So this behavior can't be something that they normally cannot do. And there must be an incentive. So there must be motivation. So if we're to look at a social learning example, you could think about the times where you modeled your parents' behavior. Whether you had a lawnmower that you would pretend to mow the lawn like your parents, or a toy car, you were modeling that behavior. So these do show a link between behaviorism and cognitivism. Bandura used this model to demonstrate why children are violent after watching violent images, behaviors, or games. You can actually look up his studies with Bobo dolls if you're interested in that. And modeling behaviors can both be positive and negative depending on the role model. The negative behaviors can be addressed through motivation and an understanding of appropriate and inappropriate behaviors. So just some food for thought, which we will look at in the discussion pages. Does the behaviorist model of learning constitute as teaching or training? Does what happens cognitively influence how an individual can learn? Can learning be a result of desire rather than consequence? And how does this explain learning that occurs independent of consequences? So this is a very quick video. It's not a comprehensive video on behaviorism, as it is meant to provide a basic understanding of its key features. So we will be discussing the strengths and weaknesses of this, as well as comparing and contrasting to other learning theories. So please email me if you have any questions about behaviorism, and we will be chatting through the discussion boards.